verse number 7. The angel of the Lord encampeth round about them that fear him and delivereth them. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man that trusteth in the Lord. Glory to God. I tell you, I start smiling when I read that. I want to pick up to where I talked about last week about angels. I remember reading in time past about a man that was a minister of the gospel in a certain denomination. He claimed to have an angel visit. And there were some men in his denomination that were about to take his papers from him. They didn't believe in angel visits. Well, the Bible doesn't say they quit. Man has said they quit, but the Bible doesn't. And so, they was about to take his papers from him because he claimed an angel appeared to him and gave him direction concerning ministry. And so one of the men there with that council said, I'm surprised us ministers don't see more angel visits. Think about that. You know why there's not a lot of people seeing angels or hearing about angels today? Because they don't believe in it.
Amen.
God will do for you what you believe in. The only part of the Bible that will work for you is the part that you believe. Because the Bible says in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 6, without faith it is impossible to please him.
Amen.
For he that comes to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. Now, some people think that God's a taker. The Bible says in John 10:10, the thief, God's not a thief, is he?
No.
Well, then who's the taker? The Bible says, Jesus said in John 10:10, the thief cometh not but to steal, kill, and to destroy. Jesus said, but I am come that you might have life, and have it what?
More
abundantly. Jesus came to give you and I the abundant life. So anything that steals, kills, or destroys from your life did not come from God. What does James 1:17 say? See, we need to get our minds our minds have been so messed up with our ideas, preachers' ideas that didn't give you the Word of God, or tradition. We need the Bible. Amen?
Amen.
My opinion is just like your opinion. Neither one of them's any good. But God's Word is good. And the Word of God says in James 1:17, I believe it is, every good gift and every perfect gift. Where does good and perfect gifts come from? From above. Every good gift, every perfect gift cometh down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variableness, neither shadow of turning. Now we understand that good gifts, perfect gifts, come from God. And who comes to steal, kill, and to destroy? The enemy. I'll be preaching in prison, and I was quoting it to the prisoners. I said, some of you are mad at God because some of the things that happened in your life did not come. God had nothing to do with it. And thank you, Lord. And the Lord just reminded me this. A lot of things that we suffer in life was because of the decisions that we made.
Right.
See, God will not override your will. Did he override the angels that fell out of heaven? Did he? No. They choose to follow Lucifer out of heaven, and so they had free will. God does not override human will. That's why the Lord said, whosoever will, let him come. Jesus, you know, I'm not a religious man. I'm a saved man.
Amen.
In the beginning was God, and in the end was God. God created the world. He created humanity for his purpose. And then man has turned it into some great, vast religion. What did Jesus say? I just quoted it in John 10:10. I've come that you might have what?
Life.
Religion? Life. No, life. Eternal life. Eternal life, if you don't get it here, you don't make it to heaven. Eternal life is imparted to your spirit when you accept the Lord Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. Amen? And when this body runs out of gas, your body is not the real you. Your body, as the Bible says, is decaying, growing older. Your body is going to the grave. It's going to run out of gas one day, and when it does, You, on the inside, you go to your home. Whoever you belong to. Amen. I belong to Jesus. You ever heard that? Watch that show, Ghost? Well, you remember when that mean guy and Ghost died? What come up out of the crowd after him?
Demons.
That's right. That's right. Well, that's who he belonged to. Whoever you belong to come after you. You see that over there in Luke 16 when the rich man died, and then the Bible says angels carried Lazarus away.
Yeah.
When he left the physical body. See, that physical body is not you. It's just a house that holds you on the earth. When the physical body expires or runs out of gas, you go to your eternal home. And I dare say everyone in here is going to heaven because you choose Jesus Christ. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Praise God. Now, it's amazing how many people, getting back to what I was just telling you about the man that claimed to have an angel visit. People in Christendom was rejecting that. But it's in the Bible. Why were they rejecting something that was already in the Bible? Because of what they were taught. It's been done away with today. It doesn't happen to us today. Who said, man said? Amen. I shook hands with people that had angel visits. Amen. I shook hands with people. More than one people I met that had angels' visits. I shook hands with people that Jesus appeared to them in a vision. Now, if I was to say that to some people, they'd say, man, that preacher down there at Cornerstone, yeah. He's a little out there. No, they're a little out there. I'm way out there because I'm closer to home base than they are, because the Word of God is home base.
Amen?
Amen. And so what I'm going to speak to you about this morning is about angels. They're very real. And the Bible even says in the New Testament, in the book of Hebrews, that some have entertained angels and didn't even know it. And see, angels are protectors, and they are also messengers. And so I just want to go over this. And it says here, and we'll read it one more time, then we go to 2 Kings, Psalms 34:7. The angel of the Lord encampeth around about them that fear him and delivereth them. They are delivering angels. Now look over at 2 Kings real quickly. 2 Kings chapter 6. I'm just going to read verse 8. We didn't read this last week. The king of Syria warred against Israel in verse 8, 6th chapter of 2 Kings, and took counsel with his servant, saying, in such and such a place shall be my camp. And the man of God sent unto the king of Israel, saying, beware that thou pass not such a place, for thither the Syrians are come down. In other words, he's telling the king of Israel where the Syrians are at. And the king of Israel sent to the place which the man of God told him, and warned him of, and saved himself there. Not once, nor twice. In other words, this happened more than two times. That the prophet saved the king of Israel from the Syrians. Therefore, the heart of the king of Syria was sore troubled for this thing. And he called his servants and said unto them, will you not show me which of you is for the king of Israel? In other words, he's saying, which one of you is a traitor? Because my plan keeps getting out. And what did they say in verse 12? And one of his servants said, none, my lord, O king, but Elisha, the prophet that is in Israel, telleth the king of Israel the words that you speak in your bedchamber. Now how could the prophet Elisha know what the king of Syria was speaking in his bedchamber unless he was there? Translation? Think about it. Miracles? I remember one time I was listening to a Christian radio program.
Spiritual wisdom.
Amen. These things are real, but if you don't believe them, they won't work in your life because God is a faith God. You can't go to heaven if you don't believe in Jesus. It takes faith, doesn't it? It takes belief. This was, I don't know the radio program, I was just listening to it one time, because when you work for Comcast for 19 calendar years like I have, and you drive a lot, you do a lot of listening at times. Amen? And so I was listening to a program, and I believe it was Kennedy when he was in office. And the Lord translated some man into his chamber there at the White House. And he looked at him and said, he kind of surprised, how did you get here? And he was telling Kennedy about some things that were going on about nuclear. And he said, how did you know that? That he knew that no one, it was classified. But the Lord was giving it to this man to tell Kennedy about something. And then all of a sudden the Lord picked him up, put him back where he was at. See, God, all things are possible with God. But when we live in a material world, and there's things that you can't do in this material world that doesn't touch God, His way of doing things, we think, oh, I don't believe that. You're getting a little bit too out there. We read it. I mean, how can a man, you know, Jesus said, as Jonah was 3 days and three nights in the whale's belly. You talk that to some people, they say, do you think I really believe that? I do. The Word of God says it. And if that's a lie, then there's no truth to none of it. Of course, I was awakened by the Spirit of God when I was 17. And I was already saved. The Lord didn't have to wake me up out of a deep sleep. Now, I was already saved. I've already believed in Jesus. And I was awakened by the Spirit of God in a deep sleep at the age of 17, but I already believed. He didn't do that to show me that He exists. I was already a believer. I already believed in the Lord. But miracles don't happen to people that try to talk them away. If you take sides against the Word of God, it'll never work for you. The part of the Bible that you take sides against that you don't believe will not work in your life. And so now Elijah's in this Syrian's bedchamber. He's hearing his words. He's looking. He can't see him. He was out of his body. Amen? You are a spirit being. You possess a soul, which is a part of your mental faculties, and you just live in a body. When you are absent from this body, you are no less man. You are still conscious. That's what Brother Irwin said. He said back when he died, he went up to about where the ceiling of his grandpa's house was and looked down and saw his mouth open. He said, I was no less man. I heard him say, he said, I was no less man out of my body as I was in my body. I just couldn't contact mama. He said, I knew everything out of my body as though I was in my body. I was nothing different. Quit thinking of yourself as just a physical being. You're more than a physical being. You are a spirit being. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. I love this life. And one of these days, heaven. The Bible says in Hebrews, here we have no continuing city. Yes. You all agree?
Amen.
There was a generation before us. Amen. There's going to be another people after us. Jesus tarries. The Bible says, here we have no continuing city, but we seek one to come. Heaven. Amen. This is not continuing. This is going to be by fire one day. But thank God there's going to be a new earth and a new heaven. Amen. Praise God. Now, in verse 12 it says, and one of the servants says, none, my Lord, O king, but Elisha the prophet that is in Israel, telleth the king of Israel the words that thou speakest in thy bedchamber. Now he has to catch this prophet. Look at verse 13. And he said, go and spy where he is, talking about this prophet, that I may send and fetch him. And it was told him, saying, behold, he is in Dothan. Therefore sent he thither horses and chariots and a great host. And they came by night and compassed the city about. Now the city surrounded where the prophet sat. And when the servant of the man of God, now notice this, look at verse 15. And when the servant of the man of God, and you know who that was, don't you? Gehazi. You remember that? Gehazi was Elisha's servant. He was supposed to be next in line for the anointing, but he was covetous and went right after Naaman. You know the story. And when the servant of the man of God was risen early, think about, well, thank you, Lord. Here's what the Lord just gave me. Y'all know the story about Gehazi and Naaman. Elisha never came out of his house. He told Naaman to go dip 7 times in Jordan. Y'all know that without me having to go over that, right? Well, Gehazi is seeing a miracle here. And it's amazing how many people have seen miracles and still won't follow God. The Lord just brought that to me. Just side journey. He was covetous and still without material things. He went and caught Naaman and lied. Because he just saw the angels here. I'm fixing to show you. It's amazing how many people know about the power of God and still love this world more than God. Now, don't get me wrong. God will take care of us here in this world. But this isn't my home. The Bible says we're passing through here. Jesus said, what shall it profit a man if he gains the whole world and loses his soul? Amen? He went on to say, what will a man give in exchange for his soul? Jesus Christ is worth more than any amount of material or money that this world has to offer, because if there's $1 trillion here and Jesus here, we went after that, that money is going to stay here. It's going to get burned up. Can't get you to heaven, but the Son of God can. Amen. Amen. Don't get me wrong. We need money to live here on the earth, and God will bless us. But there are some people that just go after the world more than they do Jesus. Amen. And it's just like what Peter told Simon that was hanging around Philip the evangelist. He said, thy money perish with thee, because thou thought thou could buy the gift of God. Amen. It's just like, now I received this from the lady. She told me personally, a friend of hers died. This is sad. Well, this is my last pastor's wife. Webby told me. One of her acquaintances, friends, her husband died. He had money. He says, when I die, I want you to put my money in my casket with me. Yeah. And so Webby, my last pastor's wife, said, well, what did you do? She said, I wrote him a check. I wrote him a check and put it in there. He can't cash it. Amen. It's amazing, but that spirit is like that. Amen. Make sure you serve the living God. Amen. Some people, when David Maxwell came and he talked about the love of money, I thought, my goodness, man, that's good. I've just been so busy since I've been selling cars. But I had a lot of time on my hand before, but man, I'm going to put that on the internet. That was a good message.
Amen.
Praise God. Hallelujah.
Yes.
Isn't the Lord wonderful? Now look at verse 15. And when the servant of the man of God was risen early and gone forth, behold, the host compassed the city both with horses and chariots, these Syrians, and his servant said unto him, my master, what shall we do? Or how shall we do? We would say, what shall we do? And he answered, here's Elisha, fear not, for they that be with us are more than that be with them. Now he's thinking spiritually. Gehazi could only see that Syrian army. They got us surrounded. But what did Elisha say? There's more with us than it is with him, because he's seeing into another world.
Yeah.
Look at that verse 17. And Elisha prayed and says, Lord, I pray thee, open his eyes. What do you mean his eyes, Brother Dennis? He had his physical eyes open, but his spiritual eyes were closed.
Yeah.
There's angels in here now. You can't see them with these eyes. Amen. There's a big fellow that follows me wherever I go. Amen. Glory to God. And they follow you if you fear God. But you can't see them with these eyes unless God opens your eyes to see into that other realm that was before this world. Then you will see them. But we get so accustomed to this world, that other world becomes distinct to us. But it's real. Amen. And so what happened? Elijah prayed and says, Lord, I pray thee, open his eyes and that he may see. And the Lord opened the eyes of the young man, who we know as Gehazi, and he saw. And behold, the mountains was full of horses and chariots of fire. Round about, what does the word of God say? Psalms 34:7, the angel of the Lord campeth what? roundabout. What does it say here? Chariots of fire. Roundabout. Elisha. He was the man of God. He didn't care what man thought about him or said about him. There was one thing he thought. Obey God. I serve the Lord God. I serve the Lord. He was God's mouthpiece. He was God's feet. He was God's hands. Whatever God said do, he did. He was obedient. And when you are obedient, you serve the living God. Boom! There's a hedge around such people. Amen, Rustin. If you see, this man paid the price. And when he says, Lord, open his eyes, Elisha was already seeing them. He said before he prayed, Lord, open his eyes, he said, oh, there's more for us. And he was just looking physically at his servant and said, what do you mean, dude? I'm looking around and I'm seeing there's more. And he says, Lord, when he did, he saw chariots of fire. He saw into the other realm. There's another world. And when you speak the word of God, the angels hearken. That's why I tell you to speak God's word. Amen?
Amen.
Now we see that they are protectors. If it wasn't for angels, I would be dead. There was times when I was in the bars and pool halls, and you know my testimony, I played with some of the best pool players in the world. And nothing was going to change that, Brandon. Man, I was on the way to the top. And I was cocky, big-headed, you know, and the Lord looked down one day, that little cocky fella in that bar, I see potential in here, I'm going to pick him up, dip him in my blood, and use him for my kingdom.
Amen.
Amen. But there was angels that was already protecting me at times I could have died. And I think about now, I said, God sent his protecting angels in there to deliver me from such destruction, from a gunshot, or whatever. Many times, the angel, oh, thank you, Lord, that's good. Here's what the Lord just gave me. If it wasn't for God and the angels, none of us would be in here.
Right.
The devil would have took us all out.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. God is a mighty God, and so are his hosts that he created. And everything is organized, and they know you. And they know if you really serve God or not. Amen?
Amen.
Now, I just wanted to show you here how they are protecting angels. I want you to go real quickly. Let's look at a messenger in the first chapter of Matthew real quickly. They're also messengers. There's different kinds of angels. I want you to look, beginning with verse 18. Matthew 1, verse 18. This is a messenger. This is a messenger coming forth. In verse 18, now the birth of Jesus Christ was on this wise, when, as his mother Mary was espoused to Joseph, before they came together, she was found with child of the Holy Ghost. Then Joseph, her husband, now look, being a just man, was not willing to make her a public example, and was thinking about putting her away privately. Why? Because she's pregnant. Hey, man, she's been with another man. That's what he's thinking. He's thinking that he's such a good man. Excuse me. He's such a good man. Now, this woman's pregnant. He's thinking, let me stop here. Let me tell you something. You need to get this. Are you hearing this? It was a necessity that God sent an angel in his case.
Yes, amen.
If you're going to see these scriptures, it was a necessity. Sometimes it's not always a necessity for God. He can work something out a different way in our cases. Okay? But when it is a necessity, why? Because he was thinking about putting Mary away because he thought, hey, she's been touched. Are you following me? This Jewish man was a good Jewish man. But here's his woman that he's espoused to, engaged to. She's pregnant. And the Bible says him being a just man was going to put her away privately because he didn't want to make her an open shame.
Right.
Now God sees what's going on. He had to send an angel in such a case as this, or he had put Mary away. In some cases of necessity, there will be an angel up here. If you need it, only God knows. Some things God can work out without sending an angel because He's God and He wants us to walk by faith.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Now let's go on reading. Verse 20. And while he thought on these things, that is, Joseph was thinking about putting her away, behold, the angel of the Lord, here it is, appeared unto him in a dream. They can appear to you right in front of you, or they can appear to you in a dream. God is almighty. He created man's makeup. He can do what he wants. The Bible says the earth is his footstool.
Yeah.
You are his creation. Excuse me. Humanity is his creation. He is God, and there's nothing too hard for the Lord God. And the Bible says, behold, the angel of the Lord appeared unto him, Joseph, in a dream, saying, Joseph, thou son of David, fear not to take unto thee Mary thy wife. See, he was about to put her away. For that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Ghost. And she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. Now all this was done that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken of the Lord by the prophet, saying, behold, a virgin shall be with child, and shall bring forth a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which being interpreted, God with us. And Joseph, being warned from sleep, did as the angel of the Lord had bidden him, and took unto him his wife, and knew her not, had no relations with her, till she had brought forth her firstborn son, and he called his name Jesus. Man had nothing to do with the conception of the Son of God. That's why he is called the Son of God. Did you know there are some preachers that don't even believe that? I would never go back to that church again. They don't believe in the miraculous virgin birth of the Scriptures. It makes every difference in the world. Because if man has something to do with Jesus' conception, he's not the Son of God, and he has the same blood flowing through us as all we do, that fallen nature.
Yeah.
Thank God, that's the Holy Ghost. Amen, overshadowed Mary. Man had nothing to do with Christ's conception. People try to talk away or explain the miracles of the Bible because they can't figure it out. You can't figure God out with your peanut between your ears. If all the human minds put together in the whole world and every country cannot touch not even 1% of God's wisdom and knowledge. We think we got it figured out, but we don't know nothing. And if there was enough to blow our nose, if their brain, some people, if their brains was exploding, it wouldn't be enough to blow their nose.
Man.
But they got it all figured out. Amen.
Come on.
They try to explain the miracles of the Bible away. Just like somebody said, bless his darling heart, about when Pharaoh went after the Israelites, when God opened the Red Sea for them by the breath of his nostrils, and they walked on dry ground. Does it say dry ground?
Amen.
You know, I like the Ten Commandments with Cecil B. DeMille. Oh, I love it, man. I get excited watching. I was like, yeah, man, look at God move. And but they got a little stream of water in there. I'm saying, hold on, the Bible says they walked on dry ground. And then the Bible says, and then when all the Israelites got over to the other side, the waters came upon the Egyptians. You know what somebody said trying to explain the Bible away again? Well, after all, the water wasn't that deep. It was just ankle deep. And you think, that poor old simpleton, if he would have just known, that would have been a greater miracle. They drowned in ankle deep water.
Amen.
Amen. Poor old simpleton. No, somebody trying to do away with the miracles of the Bible again. The Word of God is truth.
Amen.
But your little peanut mind can't comprehend it. And that's what keeps people. I remember one time years ago, I went into a man's house that was in Hollywood for 30 years in the wardrobe department. I was in there doing work for him. And he retired from Hollywood, and I was seeing his pictures in there. And his brother, he knew about Christendom. Because he said, my brother is a born-again believer. And I was trying to pray with him. to get him saved amidst hell and gain heaven. And he says, here's what he told me. And this is what people, a lot of them in Hollywood don't believe because they go into them other religions, Scientology, Buddhist, New Age. And he said, it's hard for me to believe that a man died for me. And I looked, if I remember correctly, I said, well, it'd be terrible for you to die and go to hell when somebody's already paid the price. But here's what he told me. He told me, and he was sincere. We weren't in an argument or anything like that. We were talking. He just says, Dennis, it's hard for me to believe that. Yeah, you can't be saved without believing in it.
Amen.
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 Amen. Thank God for faith.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Now, real quickly, we see right here that angels are messengers. We see that angels are protectors. Let's look one time at the protecting angel in Acts chapter 12. Acts chapter 12, real quickly. And we'll end here. I got so much to tell you. I don't know. I might do one or two more Sundays with this. It depends on what the Lord gives me. You liking it, brother?
Yes, amen.
Praise the Lord. Amen. We need more of this. That's why we don't see the Bible says the Lord confirms the word with what? Signs following. Signs follow the word, doesn't it? So if we preach about healings, we see healing. We preach about miracles, we see miracles. We preach about the name of Jesus and what it'll do, we see the results of it. We preach about angels. You get educated in this area, God might say, well, let me send them an angel down there. You know, Bree Keaton, she's coming back again, but you've heard her preach. Bree said, oh, I've been in churches and seen angels. Just wait now. Why? She's a seer. Mary Baxter, when I picked her up at the airport in 1976, the Lord took her to hell. Showed her hell and said, you go tell people this place exists. Many people of the earth don't believe it exists. And so that's what she teaches about more than anything else is hell, because Jesus took her there in 1976. Many people don't even believe that place exists. And when I picked her up at the airport, one of the first things, and Chris let me use his Lexus. So I was driving her around in a Lexus. And she looked at me and she says, now, Pastor Dennis, do you know what a seer is? And I said, yes, ma'am, I do. A seer is someone that sees into that other realm. That's what prophets were called under the old covenant. They were called seers. See, Elisha the prophet, he saw those angels. He saw them before Gehazi did. He said, Lord, open his eyes. He don't see what I'm seeing. We only see through these physical eyes. And we go by what our senses tell us. Well, you better go by what your senses tell you if you cross from 49 and you see an 18-wheeler coming.
Yeah.
Are we going to have somewhere to go in a few days? Your funeral.
Amen.
No, when it comes to the Bible, in spiritual things, we step out into another realm called faith. Amen?
Amen.
It works. Praise God. Just like Carrie was talking about Brandon and her praying, she got a pain in her side. The natural mind says, get to the doctor. Amen?
Amen?
Now, we're not against doctors. We're for them. I'll go if I have to. You will too. We're not. Doctors are against the same thing God's against, the devil.
Yes, yes, yes.
Well, anyway, what did they do? They rebuked it. And it left. You got to stand your ground, resist. Amen?
Amen.
Praise God. It's just like Esty with those headaches all those years.
I know.
Your daughter, your husband. Had them bad, didn't she?
Yeah, she did.
Commanded them to go in the name of Jesus. They left. About later, the devil tried to put them on. She says, no, I'm not having headaches again. I ain't had one in over a year.
Days like today, she'd be in agony.
She'd be in agony. But thank God the name of Jesus drove them away. See? Now, if she would have went, and we're not against doctors. Doctors don't know how to deal with that. They say, well, take this three times a day. But the name of Jesus is powerful. I've seen so many miracles over the years. I've seen miracles where medical science couldn't do nothing for the people.
Amen.
And after the name of Jesus, with hands laid on them, instantly healed.
Yeah.
You think I could quit believing this?
Nope.
Sure, I've seen too many witnesses. People I get here testify what happened to them. Miracles. And some people go to churches and say, no wonder they don't have Jesus the healer in there, because they take sides against the word of God.
That's right.
And it never worked. Amen?
Amen.
Now, you there at the 12th chapter of book of Acts? Look at 1 through 3 real quickly. Now, about the time Herod the king stretched forth his hands to vex certain of the church, and he killed James, the brother of John, with the sword, and because he saw it pleased the Jews, he proceeded further to take Peter also. Then were the days of unleavened bread. And when he had apprehended him, he put him in prison. Notice that. What did he do? He apprehended Peter and put him in prison. You know what he was going to do, don't you? Kill James. He's going to kill him. Peter is in prison, fixing to be killed, because they don't believe in this gospel of Jesus Christ. These religious Jews didn't. They didn't believe that Jesus was the Messiah. And they're saying, hey, we're going to kill this guy. But now look at verse 5. Peter, therefore, was kept in prison, but prayer was made without ceasing or stopping of the church unto God for him. See, God hears and answers prayer, doesn't he? And when Herod would have brought him forth, the same night Peter was sleeping between how many soldiers? He was listen, the command of Herod was, watch this man, keep him in prison. He's between two soldiers sleeping. And go to show you, he knew he was fixing to die. But I read Peter's epistle. He says, be careful, don't worry about anything.
Amen.
1 Peter 5, 7, I believe it is. Cast all your care upon him. He practiced what he preached.
Yeah.
He knows he's going to die. He's in there. Thank you. She brought it up. 1 Peter 5, 7. Casting all your care, that is anxieties, concerns, upon him, that is Jesus, for he cared for you. Peter practiced what he preached. We see it here.
Yeah.
He's between two soldiers and he's so much asleep. Look at this. There'll be some Christians like, I'm going to die in the morning. They'd be all anxious. The body's not you. The body's going to run out of gas. It's not you. And so look at the end of verse 6. Well, let's read verse 6 again. And when Herod would have brought him forth the same night, Peter was sleeping between two soldiers, bound with two chains, and the keepers before the door kept the prison. He's pretty much well guarded, isn't he?
Amen.
The natural mind would say, you're not getting out of here. Look at verse 7. And behold, the angel of the Lord came upon him, and a light shined in the prison. And what did he have to do to wake Peter up? And he smote Peter on the side. Peter, in such a deep sleep, he thought, I'm going home tomorrow. In other words, heaven. And the angel had to smote him on the side to wake him up. That's faith, friend.
Yeah.
Faith never is full of anxiety. If you're believing God for a miracle and you're worrying and you're anxious about it and you're full of anxiety, you have not put it in God's hands.
Amen.
You are not believing God.
Yeah.
Faith rests.
Yeah.
Amen. If you're thinking, oh, all I can do now is pray, and you're full of anxiety and you're full of concern, you haven't given it to God and you're not believing God to do it.
Nope.
Peter had no anxiety. Oh, thank you, Lord. Here's what the Holy Ghost just gave me. Faith has no anxiety.
Yes. Amen.
Because when you're in faith, you're not concerned about it. You know God's got it.
That's right.
Amen?
Amen.
Faith has no anxiety or concern concerning the thing that it's believing God to do. Amen. It says, thank you, Lord, for coming through.
Yes. Definitely.
Amen? Praise God. And we see in that verse 7, and behold, the angel of the Lord came upon him, and a light shined in the prison, and he smote Peter on the side and raised him up, saying, arise quickly, and the chains fell off from his hands. Why? Because God has all power.
That's right.
And the angel said unto him, gird thyself and bind on thy sandals and go. And so he did, and he said unto him, cast thy garment about thee and follow me. And he went out and followed him, and wist not that it was true, which was done by the angel, but thought he had saw a vision. When they were past the first and second ward, they came unto the iron gate that led into the city, which opened to them. of his own accord, and they went out and passed through one street, and forthwith the angel departed from him. Why? The angel did his job as he was commanded. Now, he didn't need to hang around no more. He did his job. He disappears.
Amen. Yeah.
Peter set free. Angels, they're sent to obey. They're sent to obey God, whether to protect or whether to give them messages. They are obedient to God, and God wants his people to be obedient.
Amen.
Amen? Don't you love that? I love living for Jesus. This is the best, grandest life. Do you believe in supernatural things?
Amen.
Amen. Praise God. Well, angels are real. The leading of God is real. God knows how to get your attention. And look at verse 11, because I'm fixing to stop here. Verse 11 says, "And when Peter was come to himself, he said, Now I know of a surety that the Lord has sent his angel and has delivered me out of the hand of Herod." See, Herod was going to kill him. "And from all the expectation of the people of the Jews. And when he had considered the thing, he came to the house of Mary, the mother of John, whose surname was Mark, where many were gathered together praying." Prayer changes. Now, let me tell you what prayer brought the angel down.
Amen.
Your prayers, God hears. You don't pray, that you get busy, and we get busy. That's what the enemy wants to keep you so busy, where you won't utter a prayer to heaven. Because God's ears. You know, God gave you and I two ears and one mouth. We need to do twice listening and less speaking.
Amen.
Amen. I've repented over my mouth. I don't know about you. But I've repented more over my mouth than any other one thing. I said, "Lord, I put my foot in my mouth again. Forgive me. If I'd have just been quiet."
That's right.
Amen?
Amen.
Now, they were praying. Don't let the devil stop you from praying.
No.
My dear brother and sister, pray. God hears and answers prayer. God is for you and not against you. Amen? With every head bowed, every eye closed.